Welcome to Dr. Will's History Road Trip. I'm Dr. Will, your host. And in this episode, we're going to do the first of our biography series. What I plan to do with this series is to highlight the biographies of some very important Americans that you may or may not have heard of, but you definitely should have heard of. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get this show on the road. The first biography tonight is going to highlight a man named Roger Sherman. Now, Roger Sherman was one of America's founding fathers. Don't get him confused with Richard Sherman. Richard Sherman plays cornerback for the San Francisco 49ers. But Roger Sherman was one of America's more important founding fathers, and you probably don't know a whole lot about him, but you probably should, because without Roger Sherman, we probably don't have a Constitution. Sherman was born on April the 19th, 1721, in Newton, Massachusetts. And what's important about Sherman is that he is the only founding father to sign the Articles of Confederation, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and a document called the Articles of Association, which cut off trade with Britain right before the Revolutionary War. He's the only guy to sign all four of those. He's not as well known as John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, but he had a major role in the founding of the United States. Now, like I mentioned, Sherman was born in Massachusetts to a farming family. As he grew older and became a teenager, he learned to make shoes. So in his early days, he was a cobbler. And in 1743, at the age of 22, he moved to New Milford, Connecticut, and got a job as both a land surveyor and a merchant. He was out surveying land claims for settlers, and also he had his own store. 1749, he married a lady named Elizabeth Hartwell. They had seven children. He became a lawyer in 1754 by passing the bar, even though he didn't have any sort of background in the law. Back in those days, however, you didn't have to go to law school and get a degree in order to become a lawyer. All you had to do was find a lawyer that was willing to teach you. You study with him, and then once he felt you were ready, he'd have the county judge come down, or local justice of the peace, and they would administer an oral exam, and if you passed it, you were admitted to the bar. And that's what happened to Roger Sherman. A lot of our early politicians became lawyers that way. Andrew Jackson became a lawyer that way. Unfortunately, his first wife, Elizabeth, died in 1760. 3 years later, he married a lady named Rebecca Prescott. They had eight children together. Now, during this time, Sherman was a lawyer. He had held various offices in the Connecticut state or Connecticut Colonial Assembly. And in 1774, he was elected to represent Connecticut in something called the First Continental Congress. The First Continental Congress was a meeting in Philadelphia. All 13 colonies were supposed to meet there. I think all but one showed up. I think Georgia may have been the only one that didn't make it. But the reason they called this meeting the First Continental Congress was to protest the Intolerable Acts. The previous fall, 1773, had seen the Boston Tea Party, where the Sons of Liberty, a group that was protesting what they saw as British tyranny, dumped over 250 cases of tea into Boston Harbor to protest the Tea Act, which gave a monopoly on North American tea to the East India Company. When they dumped that tea into the harbor, that was the last straw for Britain. There, you'd had problems going all the way back to 1763 when the French and Indian War ended. You had the proclamation of 1763, which forbid English settlers from moving west across the Appalachian Mountains. The settlers just ignored it. You had the Stamp Act in 1765, which was Britain's first attempt at an internal tax on the colonies, where they basically levied a tax on something other than trades. It's the first tax that wasn't a tariff. And that threw the colonies into an uproar. This is when you start to hear the battle cry, no taxation without representation. You had the Townsend Acts 2 years later that did the same thing. And then the Tea Act comes along in 1773 and pretty much gives a monopoly on the North American tea trade to the British East India Company. What angered colonists about that was if they can force you to buy this certain kind of tea, what else can they force you to do? Okay. So, after the Boston Tea Party occurred, Britain passed a series of laws called them the Coercive Acts. The colonists called them the Intolerable Acts because they were intolerable. One of them closed the port of Boston. One of them moved trials of royal officials out of the colonies and moved them back to Britain where they wouldn't be accountable as much. One of these acts, the Quartering Act, required you to quarter British soldiers in your home. So these things were onerous to the colonists, and they called this meeting for Philadelphia in the spring of 1774. Sherman represented Connecticut there, and he was also one of the signers of that body's Articles of Association. The Articles of Association placed an embargo on trade with Great Britain, and that's designed to hurt the mother country. The mother country made their money by taking raw materials out of the colonies, taking them back to Britain, manufacturing them into useful products, and then selling them somewhere else, including back to the colonies. So if you're not importing or exporting goods to Britain, that's designed to hurt Britain. As we all know, that little bit of coercion didn't work. Britain doesn't repeal the Intolerable Acts. And in 1775, a year later, a second Continental Congress will meet in Philadelphia. Roger Sherman returns again as a member of the second Continental Congress from Connecticut. And in this one, he's got a lot more importance. In June of 1776, so the second Continental Congress had met, been in session for more than a year at this point. There's already been shots fired. Sherman was appointed to something called the Committee of Five. This Committee of Five was given the task of drafting a Declaration of Independence. The other members you've probably heard of, except for one of them. The other four members of the committee were Robert Livingston of New York, Benjamin Franklin of Pennsylvania, John Adams of Massachusetts, and Thomas Jefferson of Virginia. Jefferson was given the job of writing the thing, and what happened is that when he got done, the others made revisions to it, and Sherman was part of that committee that oversaw it and made a few revisions. So Sherman would be one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence. Also in June of 1776, Congress appointed Sherman to a committee that drafted a plan of union. For the first time, the colonies are going to unite, all 13 colonies. Now they're all independent states, right, after they've declared independence. And they need some sort of governing body. So Sherman will be on the committee that drafted what became the Articles of Confederation. The Articles of Confederation was the first written constitution for the United States. Now, it was written there in 1776. It wasn't ratified until 1781. The states bickered over it, over things like taxation and that kind of stuff. But it wasn't ratified by the states until 1781. Sherman was a member of the Continental Congress until 1781. At that point, he left office. But when he left office and went home to Connecticut, he remained active in state politics. He served in the state legislature. And he just remained active in local affairs. In 1787, Sherman was chosen to represent Connecticut again in Philadelphia, this time at something originally called the Philadelphia Convention. Now, this is what we know of as our Constitutional Convention. The original purpose of this convention was to revise the Articles of Confederation. The Articles of Confederation by 1787 weren't working. Okay? They didn't give the central government enough power to do the things that they needed to do. They couldn't raise money. They couldn't tax without the consent of the state. Well, actually, the states, they had to borrow money from the states, to be honest with you, or had to ask the states for money. They didn't have the authority to interfere in internal rebellions. And this is what really prompts the Constitutional Convention to meet. They had already called for this convention in the spring of 1786. They were going to meet a year later in Philadelphia. But that winter, a rebellion took place in Massachusetts called Shays' Rebellion, and nobody was able to put it down for months. The state of Massachusetts didn't have enough power to go out and put this rebellion down. The federal government didn't have any authority to go put it down. So by the time these delegates showed up in Philadelphia in the spring of 1787, it became clear that most of them wanted a new document. Okay? They figured the Articles of Confederation weren't working. They needed to come up with something else. Now, Sherman was originally opposed to that. Roger Sherman thought the Articles of Confederation were working just fine. You may have to tweak them a little bit, maybe give the federal government some authority to put down rebellions like Shays' Rebellion. But he was very worried that a new constitution would give the central national government too much power. Okay. Now, once it became clear that most of the delegates at the Constitutional Convention wanted a brand new constitution, Sherman reluctantly agreed to it, but he consistently sought to limit the power of the federal government. He spoke over 138 times during the convention, so he was heavily involved in the proceedings of the convention. But his biggest contribution had to be what we've come to call the Great Compromise. And this is where I think Sherman really deserves to be remembered the most. When these delegates arrived in Philadelphia, one of the delegates, James Madison of Virginia, of course our future president, showed up with a plan of a new government already written. He'd been working on it for the past year, year and a half. And this plan would change the form of government radically. Under the Articles of Confederation, you only had one branch of government. It was Congress. And each state got one vote. So you didn't have an executive branch. There was no way to enforce the law, which was a weakness of the Articles. You didn't have a judicial branch. There was no way to interpret the law if the meaning was fuzzy. So Madison's plan called for three branches of government and a series of checks and balances where each branch would have a check on one of the others when one of them wouldn't get too powerful. The problem with Madison's Virginia plan, that's what it was called since Madison was from Virginia, from Sherman's point of view, the problem was it gave the larger states too much power. States like Virginia and New York with a large population. Under Madison's plan, representation in both houses of Congress would be based on population. The more people in your state, the more delegates you had. So in the lower house, what would become the House of Representatives, under Madison's original plan, that's going to be based on population. And then the members of that house would appoint the members of the upper house, what eventually became the Senate. Okay, well then now you've got control by the larger states. In the executive branch, the way Madison originally envisioned it, is that Congress would appoint a president. Well, if Congress is controlled by the larger states, then the executive branch will be controlled by the larger states, right? Same thing with the judiciary. So at some point, New Jersey, Connecticut, some other smaller states get together and they come up with a plan of their own. They called it the New Jersey Plan, and it kept the three branches of government, but the main sticking point was Congress. They wanted to keep Congress a unicameral Congress, one house, where all states would have equal representation, okay? Well, this caused a big uproar at the convention. The large states were adamant about this. Their argument was there are more people in our states. The things we do will affect more people in our states. We ought to have more of a say. The small states, like New Jersey, like Rhode Island, like Connecticut, they're worried they're going to be overrun by the big states. So they fight hard on it. Sherman's the guy that comes up with a compromise. And it becomes known as the Great Compromise. Sometimes you'll hear it called the Connecticut Compromise, which makes sense because it comes from the Connecticut delegation. What the Great Compromise did was essentially gave us Congress as we know it today. Sherman's compromise was this: why don't you have a lower house where representation is based on population? In other words, the more people in your state, the more representatives you get. Okay, and the people will vote directly by district for that. He said, and then why don't we have an upper house? So we're going to have a bicameral legislature, two houses, and in the upper house, what comes to be the Senate, why doesn't each state get equal representation? And that satisfies both parties. The big states still have more representation in the House of Representatives, but if they try to do anything that would just kind of overwhelm the smaller states can block that in the Senate because a bill has to pass both houses of Congress and then be signed by the president in order to become law. Sherman essentially saved the Constitution. He saved the convention. Tempers had flared to the point that some delegates of some states were talking about going home and just scrapping all this. Sherman saved the thing. So I don't think he really gets enough credit for that, and he probably should. Once Congress approved of the Constitution in September of 1787, Sherman would sign it. He went home to Connecticut and supported ratification. He was a Federalist in that sense, that he was pro-Constitution. Those that didn't want to ratify were known as anti-Federalist. And then just a few years later in 1789, he was elected to the first Congress. So he will actually be a member of the very first House of Representatives. One of the first things he did was to support Madison on a Bill of Rights. Madison had made a deal with anti-federalists in Virginia during the ratification process. They wanted a Bill of Rights listed out. In other words, there's certain rights that the people have that the government can't take away. And Madison resisted that during the writing of the Constitution. His argument was, we don't want a list of rights because what if we leave something off the list? And then years down the road, somebody comes along and says, oh, well, you don't have that right because they didn't list it back then. Sherman agreed with Madison on that. Sherman did not want a Bill of Rights listed in the original Constitution as well. But in order to get Virginia to ratify the Constitution, Madison had to make a bargain with the anti-federalists in Virginia, who were pretty strong. And there were some prominent names among the anti-federalists in Virginia: George Mason, James Monroe, another future president. So what Madison did is he promised them, if you'll ratify this Constitution, once the government gets going in the very first Congress, I'll make sure we get a Bill of Rights passed as amendments. And so, true to his word, in the first Congress, Madison did just that, and Roger Sherman supported it. He was actually fairly instrumental in the wording of the 9th and 10th Amendments. The 9th Amendment's the one that says all powers not listed here in this document, in the Constitution, basically belong to the people. And the 10th Amendment says any powers not delegated to the federal government or specifically withheld from the states belong to the states. And that's consistent with Roger Sherman's philosophy. He always opposed a central government that would be too powerful. And so he's instrumental in getting the Bill of Rights passed as well. Now, eventually in 1791, Connecticut will elect him to the Senate, and he will be a senator from Connecticut when he dies in July of 1793. Okay? So you can see in his long public life, Sherman is involved in all the major events of the founding of the country. Now, he doesn't fight the Revolutionary War because by the time it came along, he was already older. He was in his 50s. But again, he is the only man to sign the Articles of Association, the Declaration of Independence, the Articles of Confederation, and the Constitution of the United States. And when you've got somebody that's got a major hand in all that, what you've got is somebody that's very influential and someone that's also very much trusted by the people of his states. So just in conclusion, I wanted to bring this to you because I think Roger Sherman's something a person everybody ought to know about. I find in teaching classes that most kids have never heard of him. I would wager that most of you have never heard of him either, but he's a very important individual. I hope you've enjoyed this, the first in our biography series. Thank you very much for your time, and I'll see you on the road. I hope you enjoyed this edition of Dr. Will's History Road Trip. If you like what I'm doing and want to continue following, please subscribe to my channel and click the notification button so you'll get updates when I post new content. Also, please consider supporting me via PayPal, Venmo, or Cash App. Your support will enable me to go to interesting places and film them and talk about them with you. Feel free to suggest locations that you might like to see me visit in the comments below. Thank you very much, and I'll see you on the road.